Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live talk show dedicated to retouching and image post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. We'll be talking with Dennis Dunbar about compositing in just a moment, but I have a bit of light housekeeping to do first. This is a live show. We count on your interaction to help us move along, so let me show you how you will be interacting with us. You should see a panel that says questions here. If you don't see the full panel here, click on this little arrow, or it might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. Give it a click and that should expose this whole thing. You type your question in here and hit send. Let's test this thing out. Let's do this a little differently than normal. I actually have a little project that I'm working on for a future show. Can I get everybody out there, seriously, everybody out there, to type in the make and model of the monitor calibrator that you use? And if you don't use any at all, just type in none. I really want to know, everybody out there, what make and model of monitor calibrator do you use, or none if you don't use any at all? And then once the actual presentation begins, you can type in your questions and comments, and I will pass them along to Dennis. And if we have time at the end of the show, we will have a formal Q&A session. Let's see here. Remind everybody about the RetouchPro.com videos. These are different than the show you're watching right now. Most of these are very detailed start-to-finish retouch jobs where you are actually watching the entire retouch from beginning to end. Therefore, some of these shows push 3 hours long, but you cannot find a finer retouching instruction anywhere. We have all topics. We have beauty and jewelry. We have photo restoration. There are some studio work. And we also, of course, also have more technical shows about individual techniques and specialty areas such as printing and CMYK and monitor calibration and all sorts of other stuff like that. So please check those out at retouchpro.com/videos. While you are there, if you would do me the favor of becoming a patron, if you viewed last week's audience showcase show, you'll know that I've got a patron drive going on for April. I've just about burned through my savings for the show. I've burned through just about everything that I set aside whenever I first started to relaunch this as a free show last November. It's almost gone. So if you want to keep these shows coming, please become a patron. This is basically the only income that I have for these shows. We do have the advertising, and I do get a small commission for the video rentals and things along those lines, but seriously, that's nothing. The patronages are really about the only revenue I've got, and there are some side benefits to becoming a patron. You don't see any ads on the site, and you get double the upload size, and you also get a nifty little patron badge next to your name and all your forum posts to let everybody know how generous you are. The good news is we are halfway to our April target. The bad news is the April target was only 10. So that means so far, out of the hundreds of people that view these live shows and the thousands of people that view them on YouTube and all the 100,000 members we have on the site, five people think that this show is actually worth something to them. I'll let that sink in there, and you can do with that information what you will. But we really do need to get a minimum of five more for this month to make sure that we can go on to May. All right. So far, very few people have been typing in their monitor calibrator. So please, if you did not type it in, yes, I can see you. Please do type it in. I really am interested in it. I will be using that information. So that's not just a random exercise. Okay, let's see. I think that covers everything. Don't forget to Subscribe to us on YouTube at youtube.com/retouchpro. That's also where you can see Dennis's previous show on movie posters. That's where you can also see all of our other previous shows. Last week's audience showcase was particularly wonderful, so please check that out. I will paste in the link to make things even easier for you. Of course, obviously, wait till the end of the show before you go over there. Somebody remind me at the end of the show, and I will paste the link in again. Let's see here. Dennis Dunbar is a Los Angeles-based compositor and retoucher specializing in advertising and entertainment. You've seen his work on movie posters for movies like Star Trek and Harry Potter and X-Men. As I said, his previous show for us on movie posters, which was Percy Jackson, is up on YouTube. And we also took a few minutes during that show to find out all about his biography and how he got here and all that, so you will definitely want to check that out after the show today. Give me a second here, and I will switch over to Dennis's screen. He'll have a button he has to click on his side. There we go. Welcome, Dennis.
Hello. How are you doing?
Real good. Your previous show was so well received, we decided to invite you back, and you were gracious enough to accept our invitation.
Lucky me.
Lucky us. Seriously. now, the image you selected today is one of a very large shoot you were telling me about that was done for... This is like, what, a South American catalog company?
A clothing company based in Colombia.
Colombia, South America, or Colombia, North Carolina?
South America.
That's what I thought, okay.
Yeah, it was a South American client, which made an interesting twist.
Yeah,
the whole
are you a Spanish speaker?
I speak very little Spanish.
So how did this work?
Well, the client spoke English, and in this project, I was brought in by the photographer, Richard Radstone.
Okay.
He's also based here in L.A., and I worked on several projects with Richard. So Richard was the primary go-between between the client and myself. But we, at the very beginning of the project, we did have 3 days in studio, where Richard was photographing the models and props and things like that, and the clients were there, and while he's shooting stuff, I'm starting to mock up things and rough together stuff and going with the clients. And they spoke enough English that we didn't have any problem communicating that way.
Now, is this a pretty typical way for you to get work of this sort?
Yeah, most of the time when I'm working on projects like this, the photographers are the ones bringing me in. What I keep hearing from art buyers at ad agencies is the vast majority of times the preference is that the photographer have a relationship with the retoucher, mm-hmm. and so they almost always defer to whoever the photographer's retoucher is for that. You know, it's all about the hiring the photographer for his vision, for his ideas, mm-hmm. and it's all about helping him execute his ideas.
So your basic advice to any aspiring professionals in the audience would basically be network with photographers rather than trying to waste your time with agencies and studios and things along those lines?
That's been a great source of work for me. You know, I hate to give away the tricks that way. But
that's our job here. This is Retouch Pro.
But it's I've really seen a lot of growth in my business. The more I pursued working with photographers and connecting with photographers and finding people whose work I loved and saying, hey, I'd love to work with you.
But now you were telling me a little earlier that you actually have a pretty intimate relationship with this particular photographer. He actually consulted you about costing and budgeting and things along those lines. Is that pretty typical a relationship for you?
What happens a lot of times with bigger projects is when the photographer is bidding on the job, he'll contact me through email or call me on the phone or whatever, and we'll talk about the job, and usually we have some thumbnails or some description about what's going on, and we try to come up with a ballpark estimate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as you can imagine, estimating, retouching before this anything even shot, you have no idea what could possibly be involved.
Absolutely.
Like, you take wild guesses.
Okay.
And then they usually work it from there. With this particular case, this was going to be a large project. We had 10 basic ads to produce, and then each ad would have three different models for it. These were all men's clothing, so three different guys placed on each background. So it was a total of 30 images.
Mm-hmm.
But the majority of work was building the backgrounds, and Richard knew that this was going to be way more than he could handle on his own. So he contacted me and said, like, let's approach this as collaborators. So let's come up with an estimate for the retouching. He came up with an estimate for what his creative fees were going to be. And then we also worked in a budget for stock imagery.
Mm-hmm.
And then whatever we were able to save from stock imagery by using our own stock images or whatever was sort of like money we would divide between the two of us. So that worked out really well. But part of the problems with that is you say, oh, this is going to be X number of dollars, and you figure it's going to take 3 weeks to do, and then it takes 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Then, like, all of a sudden, your dollars per hour is declining rapidly.
That's where a little experience comes in. But I like that concept of, of being a collaborator rather than just a freelance labor.
Yeah, and that's where it gets to be a lot of fun. That's the part I really enjoy about the work, is the collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, creating cool-looking images is the big fun. But it's the collaboration, too, where the two of you are playing off ideas and making suggestions. And, you know, when you work with somebody who's a really talented creative, they can take a look at something and make a suggestion that wouldn't have occurred to you. Like, wow, all of a sudden it got a lot better. Or if they're receptive and you have a good relationship to them, you can say, like, hey, what if we do this? And they're receptive about it. So in my experience, retouchers are almost never hired for their style.
Mm-hmm.
It's more helping the client, the photographer, the agency, execute whatever style they're looking for.
So, not to make any great logical leaps here or whatever, but do you go out of your way not to really have a style of your own?
I go out of my way to listen carefully to what the clients are asking for.
Ah, very tactful.
And try to help them see where their particular thing is. I enjoy working on a wide variety of stuff. As you said, I work on movie posters, mm-hmm. products, fashion, a lot of commercial ads. And so there's a wide range of imagery. And I remember in the very beginning, when I was working on a lot of movie posters, one of the art directors said, like, oh, you're really good with stuff on white. I'm like, well, that's just because that was the last couple of things you saw me do. It's like, I can do a lot more than that.
Like, thank you?
Yeah, I was sort of like, thank you, but like, if it goes against a dark background, I can't do it. It was kind of funny, because in the beginning, a lot of photographers would talk about not wanting to be pigeonholed
mm-hmm.
for a particular look or whatever. You know, they would complain a lot that, this is like 15, 20 years ago, photographers would say, like, if clients didn't see it in your portfolio already, they didn't think you could shoot it.
Mm-hmm.
So if they wanted bicycles on a bike path,
mm-hmm.
and they didn't see you shot bicycles on a bike path, they saw you shot roller skaters on a roller skating path, they couldn't make the leap. So but the very same photographers who complained about that would also point to retouchers and say, like, oh, you're really good with working on blonde hair. This person's good working on dark hair. I was like, well, wait a minute.
Now, I've heard similar complaints about Hollywood. So do you think that might be like a left coast phenomenon, that the mindset out there is just so blinkered, or do you think that that's probably industry wide?
I think a fair amount of it is industry wide. I think what an awful lot of it is a sense of is there's a lot of pressure to deliver,
mm-hmm.
and so people want to feel.
They want a sure thing from the gate.
They want a sure thing. There's a bit of, I suppose you could say, it's like fear-based decision-making.
Okay.
This happens a lot with movie posters. The reason why you see the same kind of designs in movie posters over and over again is because a lot of times the marketing departments and the studios are afraid if they try something different and it doesn't work, they're out of a job.
Okay.
If they try the same proven formula and it doesn't work, well, obviously it wasn't their fault. But if they try a twist on something, I remember working on a poster for a Jackie Chan movie. And it was one of the rare times where the studio person came into the ad agency and was working over the shoulder with me. And I heard commenting to somebody like, yeah, Jackie didn't want to be in a martial arts pose for this one. But if we thought about it, and if we were the first to not have him in a martial arts pose and it didn't do well, we'd all be out of a job.
Hmm?
So, of course, Jackie had to be in a martial arts pose for that poster.
So I guess the takeaway here is you want to have your portfolio be very, very, very large and then try to customize it, pare it down for every particular person there or every particular situation that you're submitting it for.
Yeah, you want to make sure whatever's in your portfolio is good work. One of the things I hear consistently from art buyers and from photographers reps is, if you have 10 pieces that are really great and one piece that's mediocre, the thing people are going to remember is the mediocre.
Mediocre one, yeah.
So you want to make sure that your work, the work in your portfolio is really good. But I think it is, you're in a stronger position if you can show a variety of types of imagery so that when people look at this, like, I have a beauty shot. Oh, I see you do lots of beauty stuff and you do this other cool stuff. So obviously you know what you're doing.
Okay.
But if all you have are beauty work and they're like, okay, we've got some beauty product models and stuff that we need working on. I see you're really good with the skin, but what can you do with product shots?
Now you recommend working with photographers. Do you find them just as silly as the art directors, or do you find them, more open-minded?
Sometimes.
Okay.
Sometimes I find that, but an awful lot of that's in developing the relationship.
Okay. So you might actually know of it, have had some exchanges with a photographer before he even sees your work the first time?
Yeah, a lot of times. I mean, one of the things I'll do a lot of times is reach out to photographers whose work I like and say, hey, I'd love to work with you.
Okay, that actually sounds like pretty good advice.
Every once in a while you get a response back, and so you're kind of initiating that. I also, here in Los Angeles, I've been a member of the American Photographic Artists, APA, for quite a while. And I go to a lot of the events and try to meet as many photographers there as I can. Mm-hmm. And again, that's the sort of thing that takes a while to really build up the recognition. But, slowly but surely, you find after repeatedly doing this and meeting people over and over again, you start getting more and more calls for work. Or more, I'm saying, like, oh, yeah, I'd really love to find a project to work with you on. So rather than always having to chase them, you're just kind of like getting to know them, and they're like coming out like, hey, I want to approach you about a job.
Now, do you find that photographers are generous when sharing retouchers, or do they not tell anybody else about Dennis Dunbar or whatever?
No, I think for the most part they tend to share the resources.
Okay.
There's a number of online social media forums that I see, and if somebody's going to be shooting in San Francisco, like, oh, I have a job in San Francisco, I need a digital tech, I need an assistant, any recommendations?
Okay.
You'll see several people popping up with that. Really the same thing with retouchers. Retouchers tend not to be, you don't have to be as regionally based. I work with people in San Francisco, I work with people in New York, all over the place. So it's not as regionally based.
Okay. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Now, let's see. We spent a little bit more. I mean, this is all fascinating and useful information, but I did spend a little bit longer on this than I intended. You wanted to show, before we dive into this one particular image, you just wanted to show the whole gamut, to the whole spread.
Right. This project involves 10 different backgrounds, like I said, and then different models placed against each of these. So these are some of the ones. This one was one of my favorite because we had to wrap the accordion around this tree. And accordions don't wrap or bend like
that. Yeah, that's they're not known for
so
that.
So it took a lot of slicing and dicing. And then after we got all the look for this, it always looked more like rings around the thing, but that was about as close as we could get. But once we got done slicing and dicing and putting that on, the agency said, or the client said, oh, we need this white diamond pattern on that. So then I had to go back and do that. And I created the diamond pattern, and then I used the warp tool to warp it on, and it was this project where the warp tool suddenly made sense to me. Like, when I didn't worry so much about how the diamonds were laying up, but I worried about the lines inside the warp tool and made sure all the lines fell in the right spot, everything fell into place. Like, wow! So that was actually one of the first tutorials I wrote. I wrote a few tutorials for one of the sites, and one of the first tutorials I wrote was about how to wrap the diamonds around there.
Okay.
This one is the one we're going to talk about today, the Bucaramanga. This one here, I forgot what region this was, but they wanted all these balloon characters. Supposed to be a lot of music in this region.
I will be perfectly honest. I had to look at that a second and a third time for it to finally dawn on me that those were notes. That's not the first thing I thought that were floating in the air the first time.
One of the things that was funny with this was the photographer thought, okay, we're going to need a balloon guy to make all these shapes out of balloons. And the balloon guy wanted some outrageous amount of money just for making the balloon stuff. You know, he called up guys who normally do kids' parties for, you know, $100, and they were wanting, you know, $1,000 or whatever like that to do balloon stuff. And I said to him, Richard, you know, we can composite the balloon shapes. You really just need to take, you know, see, each one is going to be a section. You just need to, you know, have somebody twisting sections of balloons and photograph the different selections. So that's what he did, and we wound up compositing them. And then once we got, like, this kind of a note, we just shifted the color and warped it a little bit and moved it around.
Cool.
And same thing with the other ones.
All right.
So I was like, oh, that wound up being really easy. So within a few hours, we had created all the notes we needed for that rather than spending, you know, $1,500 on a balloon guy. This one here, I forgot what the name of this region was, but the idea was to have all these fish floating, swimming around the model.
Yeah.
This one was another region known for music, and they wanted harps in that. This one had all these colorful origami flowers on the trees, so we had to, there were bare branches, and then photographed different origami type flowers, and we just kept compositing and you know, duplicating and twisting and colorizing, and so that was a lot of fun. This one was a sugarcane region growing.
Okay, those are cotton candy balls, whatever you call those.
Cotton candy balls. So we found stock imagery of sugarcane growing and created this sort of a roadway look, and then photographed cotton candy and popped all that in. This one was in Bogota, and sort of a play on the Rene Magritte,
mm-hmm,
where we
right,
got the sky and the umbrella. And then this one was for the coffee growing region. For this, so we used stock imagery to create the hills. I think the sky was something I shot while on vacation, and then Richard photographed the model, and he had some shots of foreground grass, and then we had the different coffee cups, created the steam, and the one of the rainbow colors steam.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a wide range of imagery. You go. The one we're going to talk about today is this one.
Just out of curiosity, how long did this whole project take you?
Wound up taking about 2 months.
Okay.
Which was about a month longer than we originally thought it was going to take. Which is where I learned about the dangers of having a flat estimate.
Oh, okay. All right.
For something, because, you know, what you think is going to take 10 hours, if it takes 20 hours, you're making half as much money as you thought you were. But it turned out to be a great project. So for this one, the idea, I wanted to show I have some of the layouts here. This is what the basic layout they gave us.
Like a comp that they made
for that. Like, okay, we want something like this.
Okay.
So that was where we got the idea for creating this. And when we were first starting out, Richard photographed. He went around and drove up into the mountains and photographed lots of different meadows and grassy areas to establish his camera angle.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went into the studio on the day he was going to be shooting the props and the models and all that. And as he was shooting the models, I would rough together the background, and I would strip out the model, you know, really quickly, take a couple of test shots, strip out the model, drop it in, make sure the perspective worked, the lighting worked, and all that. So that was really critical in making everything work, that we established the perspective and made sure everything followed that same perspective, and that Richard was keeping the lighting, whatever lighting we had in mind, keeping that uppermost in his mind as he shot. So we got that all to agree. The way this is constructed, this is built together like any kind of composite is going to be built together in sort of a common thing. So you see here in the layers palette, we have several layer groups. And it looks fairly simple. You've got grass, bicycles, shadows for the overall. You got the model. You got trees.
Are these roughly in chronological order, or does that have nothing to do with anything?
They're not in chronological order. They're in order of basically the way I build it is what makes sense to go on top. So like the model, since he's in a foreground and got all the stuff behind him, it makes a lot of sense to have the model in the upper layers.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Because that way, if I had the model in the base here, I'd have to cut out a hole in the trees, I'd have to cut out a hole in the sky, I'd have to cut out a hole in the grass,
sure.
I'd have to cut out a hole in everything so you could see the model come through.
And obviously the sky isn't the total back.
I just have the model masked out, and you know, it works just fine.
Okay.
So it simplifies that. So that's one of the important things about compositing, is to think about your layer structure. I also use layer groups for this. This is a folder with all these layers here for the layer groups, and their names, so we can see exactly what's what for that. And then each layer in the layer groups has its own name as well. So I really try to be good about avoiding anything that says layer 37 or whatever. So you can see here this guy here. If I highlight this and go over, like, there's the file name for the stock image we use.
Okay.
The Shutterstock, whatever number is. So if anybody ever asks me, where did this guy come from? I know exactly where it came from because the name is in there.
Good idea.
Okay, great. You used the one we approved. Nothing like, you know, working on something several hours and having a client look like, wait a minute, where'd that shot come from? And then you tell them, and like, you trace through the emails, like, okay, it was my mistake.
Okay.
I gave you the wrong number. I'll pay you for the work you did instead of, like, oh, you screwed up. You have to redo the work for free. So name your layers. The other thing you'll notice is that in addition to layer groups, we're also using clipping groups.
Mm-hmm.
So these little bent arrows here. And what the clipping groups mean is that the layer they're clipped to also acts as a mask for the layers that are clipped to it,
mm-hmm.
which means when I'm adjusting color or adding retouching, I don't have to worry about following a mask really carefully. I can be sloppy and go beyond the mask, and it's not going to cause any problem because this layer is going to make sure it doesn't show up where it shouldn't. If we come up to the model and look, if I let's see if this will work here. If I unclip this edging work, you should see, yeah, you see how all this paint here shows through?
Right.
But if I step back a thing, now all that paint work that I did is constrained in here. I don't have to have this mask here as well. So it simplifies it. I have one mask doing the work for several layers, and that means if I have to adjust the one mask, there's just one mask to adjust.
Okay.
I don't have to go back and fix it 10 times. So that's the other important thing about layer structure and the way you build it. And then finally, in the layer groups, not only can layers have blending modes, but layer groups can have blending modes. And the default blending mode for layer groups is pass through. Mm-hmm. But you notice if I change this from normal to pass through, everything shifts around because I have these adjustment layers here, these adjustment layers here that are affecting everything. For the, like this one's darkening the guy. Mm-hmm. And these are adjusting skin color and toning down highlights and all that. So rather than having to have this mask here copied up to here, I can just have this darken on there. And part of the reason why I didn't want to have this mask set up on the top is also part of the thing for the hair, to make the hair look natural, is I have this layer here called hair work. And it's just little bits of painted hair to kind of help blend in the hair. It's just little strokes of, okay, of paint.
Sure.
For that. But that wouldn't be included in the mask for them because it's part of what you're adding on there. So by using blending modes and knowing how to make the blending modes work for you, this simplifies the whole thing. I can have adjustment layers affecting all, everything below there. That shows up really a lot when we go here to trees. We come to here to moss balls. These are all the little moss balls here. Mm-hmm. And since I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different moss balls that we have in the foreground here, rather than having the adjustment layers, the color adjustment layers, clipped to each one and having to duplicate them over and over again, I just have one set up here. And changing them once changes them for everything for that.
And so you would have...
So that's a little bit about the layers.
You
layer
would
structure.
Have that folder on normal as well? Is that your normal way of working?
Yes. The blending mode on this is normal. I set it to normal blending mode when I need to add the adjustment layers and all that to it.
So what, pass through would skip those?
Also, what?
Pass through would skip those?
Pass through would allow the adjustment layers to affect everything.
Ah, okay. So they affect everything even outside of the folder.
Right.
Okay.
Right, everything. And when it's on normal, the adjustment layers only affect what's inside that. That's the primary purpose. I mean, that, for me, that's the biggest benefit for having a layer group on blend, a layer group's blending mode on normal. But the when you set the layer group blending mode to normal, sometimes it can override other blending modes you're using.
Hmm.
So that's one of the things where, like, sometimes it doesn't work. You set it to normal, like, uh-oh, now this overlay noise layer I have is looking funky because normal, you know, it's forcing that to have normal blending, not overlay blending or whatever. So it's something where, like, okay, when I set it to that, I see a problem, like, oops, let's go back, and now we have to do it, you know, the old-fashioned way. But wherever possible, I try to leverage the blending modes as much as possible.
Now, do you remember what the chronology was of building this?
I know in the very beginning, once we started working on the stuff, we started roughing ideas for the backgrounds out before, when Richard was scheduling everybody and arranging for the shoot. We had a couple days where just roughing together backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
For that, he shot a bunch of images driving around and all that, and we were collecting skies and things like that. Each one of those, each one of the ads had a layout given to us like the other ones. We had a rough idea what they wanted.
Mm-hmm.
So we just started roughing that stuff together. They shot stuff in the studio. He shot the models and the props and the trees and all that stuff in the studio. And then once we were done with that, then it was back to building backgrounds. And since Richard could do a fair amount of retouching, he would start on the things that he thought he could handle easily while I was tackling the things that were more challenging.
Okay.
So like if I masked out the model, he felt confident in like retouching skin and all that for a lot of the models.
No.
So, okay, here, the model's masked out. You do the retouching. I'm going to work on building the background. And then when you've got your thing done, pass it back over to me. and we bring that in. So that's part of why, also why it's important to name your layers, is if you're passing files back and forth from person to person, mm-hmm. or sharing a file and copying layers, if you've got a funky structure and you haven't named your files and stuff, everybody else down the line is going to get confused because nobody will know what's going on.
Okay. Now you had an interesting anecdote concerning the grass.
Oh, yeah. When Richard photographed the model, let me come over here and under elements. This is, that we can also talk a little bit about the masking process for this, but this is the photograph for the model. Richard had white seamless in the background. He had him sitting on grass in the, he brought in some sod and had them sitting on grass for that because he thought, oh, it'd be really easy to blend it in. The guy's already sitting on grass. We don't have to illustrate grass over him. And that worked fairly well, except for the length of this grass was different from the length of here we go, from the length of this grass.
Right.
So we got longer grass where the guy's sitting. It's almost like he's been sitting there a long time. it kind of adds this realistic thing to it, I guess. He's been sitting there so long, the groundskeeper just went around.
Mowed around him, yeah.
But if you look carefully, like we got shorter grass and we have longer grass. That's because there's no way I couldn't make that grass short because it was on top of the guy, unless I retouched
every blade of grass off. Right.
And on one of the other shots, which one is it? This one. On this shot here, when Richard photographed the guy, he had this long kind of grass in front of the guy's legs as well. And then that meant having to mask out these little blades of grass and having not only where they went in front of him, but continuing all the way over. That had to be masked out perfectly because you didn't want to have like weird background stuff showing through. So it became really difficult, a real problem masking and having to carefully trace and paint and create grass. It would have been a lot easier if he's standing and we had maybe some tufts of grass that we could have masked out separately and then lay on top of the guy, or maybe illustrate some grass for that. Long grass like that would be hard to illustrate, but short grass like around here, you could illustrate fairly easily. Just find the right color and may use a small brush and just paint some grass in there, and you could illustrate just enough grass to make it look real for that. So it would have been easier had he not done that. But that's part of the thing that you learn for it. This bicycle, he photographed the bicycle in the grass, so I had to mask out every one of the spokes and then clean them up and get the grass.
But now you did have an interesting, you did have a fascinating technique for masking out those spokes.
Oh yeah, for masking out the spokes, do I have the? Oh, I don't have the image handy for the bicycle. Mm-hmm. But if we come over here, we can go to bicycle, and see I got it in a layer group. I can find it really easily. Now if I just for simplicity, if I duplicate this out to a new layer, you see here's our masked out thing. This is just a bicycle. But if I turn off the mask, you can see
okay. The
way it shot. And so what I wound up doing to mask out each of these things was I used a series of paths going around, tracing around the subject. Oh, you can see where some of my retouching was accidentally done on the wrong layer. I had to carefully trace around everything with a path. And for these things, what I wound up doing was, if I remember right, I made a path for each one of these and then finding a very small brush and then just stroking the path. So each of these things was masked out.
I thought that was very clever.
So this is what the mask looks like for those. And then where the grass is blending in, this could be a soft edge mask because we were blending grass in. And so we wanted some of that grass to come up, but where it had to be really clean, had to do a lot of work on here, cleaning this up and making sure this is as exact as I could make it. For that, the little cables and stuff were done the same way. Just draw a path, very tiny brush, stroke it,
I like
so
that.
So it took a lot of work masking each and every one of these things out.
Okay, now,
But that was how this was put together.
If you were to pick out one element of this particular image that you would say would be your most typical type of compositing situation, what do you think it might be?
Probably the most typical thing would be stripping a person against a background.
Well, what can you show us that, how you did that then?
Yeah, I can show you how I did the masking. This is the shot of the guy. Now this image was created in 2009. Mm-hmm. This was before Photoshop was using smart objects and refine edge and stuff as much as it does now. Okay. So my techniques have been, you know, a little more refined from those days. But this was the basic thing. What I typically will do here with this is, I don't think we have time to go and remake the whole mask, but what I typically start off with these days is I'll draw a path, come close around to the edge of the hair, but not really care too much about getting the hair perfectly. Try to get the big chunks of it. And then I'll zoom in closer and start tracing around the edge of the image here. And the idea here is I just want to nick the inside of it, mm-hmm. because I'm going to need to have some feather coming out, and I want that feathering edge to have the image, not the background.
Okay.
So I'll go along and trace along here until I've got the whole thing traced out. And you can see this could take a while to do.
Yeah.
The more you practice with the pen tool, the faster you get.
Now, on the grass part underneath them, did you just do like a straight line under the grass, or did you still try to kind of...
Yeah, what I did was, since we're going to be sitting on grass, I just included a large area here.
Okay.
Just like this, and then went back up and go around this clean edge here. But where we're going to have grass blending up over the guy, I wanted a larger swath of it so that I could blend it in more easily. You could have a soft mask here, and hopefully nobody notices the difference in the transition between the grass. You know, this pattern can be kind of chaotic, so you get away with some sins that way. But, you know, you trace really carefully around here. So once I've gotten that done, I turn that into a selection, and I can show you the refine edge thing. We'll just quickly finish this off. Here, let's just...
Yeah.
Do this here where we'll grab some of the background here, not worrying too much about it.
And you always aim for the inside. I think that's interesting.
Just the inside. I also take advantage of using the arrow keys to bump. If I put a point down, it's not in the right spot. Mm-hmm. You can use the up, down, left, right arrow keys to move the point around, which is a huge help. I can move a lot faster knowing I can go back and adjust these things. I'm not trying to be perfect with every single placement.
And what do you consider the inside on hair?
Well, with this, I'm going to use refine edge to capture as much of the hair as I can.
So you don't want any, you don't want any background at all showing through the section that you have selected.
Right. I don't want that because then that's going to be a little more work to get refine edge to mask out. Refine edge does a good job of getting you about 80% of the way there on the hair mask. Mm-hmm. You still have to get in and do some hand massaging to make it work, but you know that's part of what we can demonstrate. Okay, so now we have a path here. We come over here to the pass palette, and I can command click on the work path. First, let's say this. Just double click on it. Normally, I'll give it a name like outline, so I know it. Because sometimes I'll have several masks for this. Might be, you know, eyes. Might be, you know, hole here. Might be. I might have a mask, a path for a book or something like that. So I'll name all the paths for this. But with this selected, I can either command click on the icon here and turn into a selection, or I can come over here and say make a selection. Mm-hmm. The difference is if I command click, it uses whatever the previous value here was.
Okay.
So if I had one where I use a 10-pixel feather and I command click the next one, that also gets a 10-pixel feather.
Okay.
So if I occasionally do it by hand this way, it just reminds me mentally, like, okay, that's got a 1 pixel feather. Do I want one? Do I want two? Do I want 20? Mm-hmm. In this case, we'll say one is good. So we say, okay, turns it into a selection. Now, just for grins, I'm going to duplicate that layer, delete the mask here, because we want to come up with a mask. I don't want to mess up the mask ahead. Mm-hmm. So this is what we wind up with for the mask. And you see the hair looks really bad. Yeah. The area around here doesn't look too bad. In order to be able to see clearly how my mask is working, what I'll do is I'll make a contrasting color layer behind it. So I just call it color or whatever. Make sure it's below that layer. Select some sort of a color. The idea is just something with a lot of contrast. Mm-hmm. So I like to say this is like a worst case scenario for that, because something like this is going to be really hard. And if you have mistakes around here, if you have some of the white background showing up or some of that, you'll see real clearly. But it looks like we actually did a pretty good job. I think I missed some here. So we see where his cheek comes in a little bit. So I'd have to work a little bit on that. Mm-hmm. But here's where I can go in and start refining things. So the first thing I'm going to do is take a look at refining the edge around his hair. And to do that, I can bring up the properties window. And here's the properties window. And here is mask edge. I can click on mask edge here to bring up mask edge. Oh, refine mask is on the other monitor. There we go. Okay, so here we have a couple of different settings and tools we can do. These are global settings, so if I feather it and I shift the edge around like this, you can see I can give it a globe. It's a global setting, so I want to be kind of conservative with this. If I checked it out initially and it looks like that was pretty good, I'm not going to worry about these too much. If I use Smart Radius, I can use Smart Radius to capture a lot of the stuff around the hair.
Okay.
But also, you see, it can also affect the other area around here. Mm-hmm. Now, this is partly why it's good to have a path, because I could go back and fix this area with a pen path, you know, with making the selection and start over to that area. But to tell you the truth, most of the time I'm not using the Smart Radius thing at all. I just use this brush here. This thing here, you can choose the size of your brush, change the size of your brush. And then I just come over here and I try to brush mostly on the outside, catch a little bit on the inside, but I'm brushing mostly around the outside here. And it doesn't have to be one stroke. You can do it in several strokes. It just takes a moment for it to update.
And what settings is it using for that brush?
It uses, I'm not sure how the
smart, its own smart internal settings or whatever?
I think, well, the size of the brush is affecting it. Mm-hmm. So you're telling it how large of an area to sample out and check out that way.
It's actually doing a pretty good job.
So I think it's basically just using that, and it's kind of trying to go back and read the values in the image and see what seems to be the contrast. So the more contrast you have between your what you want to keep and then what you want to get rid of, the better this works.
Hmm.
This guy's hair, you know, in certain parts of his hair, it was really pretty light compared to the background. So it wasn't that much of a contrast for it. So if he had dark hair, this would be a lot easier to work with.
It still looks
since
pretty nice.
We had a light
colored
background. But you know, it's not too bad. So we'll click OK, and then we take a look at the mask here, and you can see like, okay, the thing with masking, where it's black is going to hide your subject, and where it's white is going to reveal it. Gray is going to allow some transparency to go through. So the edges of the hair, we want some transparency, but the inside parts, like here, we want this to go to white. And that's where I use the dodge, burn, and blur tools.
Okay.
So with dodge tool, I'll set this to highlights because I want to force the whites out. And the exposure, it all depends on how comfortable you are with this. I do it a lot, so I'm pretty comfortable with 100%. If I'm going to use the burn tool, I set this to shadows and go that way. And then I use the blur tool to soften the mask. So first I'm going to do with this is I know I want to bring the whites out. RetouchPRO. So I'll make my brush a little bit smaller, and I'll brush in the inside here. And this is getting rid of, if we look here, it's getting rid of some of those transparent areas on the inside where it looks like we've lost some of this real hair.
Now you can, if you so choose, yeah, you're painting right now on the mask, even though you are viewing the image.
Right, right. And I find working both ways with this, between viewing, looking here at the mask and working at the image, you just have to make sure you have the mask selected.
Mm-hmm.
One of my pet peeves is I really wish Adobe made this more obvious.
Or lockable.
See this little, the little outlines there?
Yeah.
I keep asking him, you know, can you give us an option? Like, I'd like it to be fuchsia. So when I look at this, like, it's obvious because the black layer here, a black thumbnail, surrounded by a portion of a black line, isn't that obvious to me? And it'll be many times when I'm working on here and doing this, like, what's going on? It's not giving the result I want.
Yeah, well, like we saw in your bicycle.
Burning or dodging the layer itself. So I got to make sure I'm clicked on the actual layer mask. I'm using the dodge tool here to work on this. I could use the brush tool, but if I use the brush tool and I went outside like this, then I have to come back in and correct it. So the dodge tool makes this part a lot easier to go. I can be faster and watch what's going on. I can be faster and capture all this stuff without worrying about being too exact about my brush strokes.
Can you back, can
after
you back
I've gone
off
around
with
there
the burn tool,
like,
or does that not work that way?
The burn tool also works that way, because I was about to say, then what I'll do is once I got the whites going out the way I want, then I'll come back in, and sometimes here it just needs a little tapping with the with the burn tool. Sometimes it's a little more stroking. A lot of times what will happen is you'll get a lot of dark grays extending way out of here. And a dark gray where you're not getting hair, but you're getting background, is going to represent some of that background bleeding through
onto
you're compositing on. So that's why you want to make sure the areas that's supposed to be black are black, and the areas that's supposed to be white are white. And then lastly, I'll come in with the blur tool. I have them set up for keyboard shortcuts. Mm-hmm. So for me, O is the burn and dodge tool, and R is the blur tool. So I can have one finger on each key with my free hand and just switch back and forth. It'd be nice if I could have different kind of icon show up for them. But they don't have that, so sometimes I get confused by this. So I'll go around here and just add a little bit of softness into this for that. And when I'm done working with it all, this one will be actually a little kind of crunchy.
But it worked.
This one here was done with a different method where we use a channel pull, and I can show you guys how to do the channel pull really quickly.
Okay.
But when I'm done with it, you wind up getting a mask similar to that. And the final piece, the final work on this, if we come over here to our model, this is where we add in that painted hair work.
Okay.
So the final touch is stroking in, the little stray hairs, painting them in. That. And that takes practice. Mm-hmm. I choose a very small brush. It's really going by the size of the individual strands of hair. And I keep sampling hair color, stroke, stroke, sample hair color, stroke, stroke, trying to fit with the pattern of the hair.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, these hairs are going like this, so the strokes will be like that. This curl kind of comes around here, so a stroke like that. But that's how you wind up finishing off the hair mask. Covering up the areas where you got background bleeding through, like here,
mm-hmm.
But we're painting in hair masks and things like that, doing it that way.
Okay. Now, what is this channel pull thing you were talking about?
Channel pulling, I wanted to show over here, so I have some really good examples for channel pulling, like this. This is one of the trees that we used in here.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the shot. So for this image, making a mask out of this. If I had to make a pen path around here,
yeah, that would be a nightmare.
You would see how much work this could be, going around and around and tracing all around. That would be mind-numbing. So this is again where having contrast between what we want to keep and what we want to get rid of helps a whole lot. So for this, the channel pulling thing, again, let's make a copy of this thing, turn this one off, and we'll turn off our mask so we can just quickly talk about this. The first step is you look at the individual channels, red, green, blue, and look for the one that seems to have the best starting contrast between what you want to keep and what you want to get rid of. So red looks pretty good for here, but these areas are kind of light. Green's kind of helpful. Blue looks like this is the darkest. So let's do this. So channel pulling comes from, you take the channel and you pull it down to this new channel icon. And you just make a copy that way. So that's where the name channel pulling comes from. My friend Lisa Carney, I think, was the first one I heard use that term. But it's a great way to demonstrate. You pull the channel down to the new channel icon and make a copy of it. And then the next thing is you want to boost the contrast for this. There's a lot of ways you can do it. My favorite way to do it is with curves tool, because sometimes you want to find the exact area here. This may not be right in the middle value. This may be a lighter or darker value than middle gray. So using levels, you may not have the right point to be able to pop contrast right around this area. If you use the contrast, brightness contrast thing, you're definitely not going to have the control you need. So that's why I like to use curves for it. So you come over here to layer or image adjust, because we're not doing it on a layer, we're doing it on the mask. Right. So you have to use this adjustment. And Command M is the shortcut for curves. Let's bring the curves over here. And what I'm going to do is, oftentimes I'll start off by clicking the white point tool, clicking there, forcing that to be white, click on the black point tool, try to find something as close to that as I can without getting too much. Now you see, this gives us something that we're going to have to work with, adjusting that, because we've got a bunch of gray showing up in here. But for the most part, this is capturing a lot of tree and getting rid of a lot of background. Okay. We have some things cleaned up, of course, but it's pretty close. You see what we've done here is the white point here is now forced over to this point. Mm-hmm. When we clicked on the white eyedropper, it did this. And then the black point is pulled all the way over here. Click on the black eyedropper, it pulled it all the way over here. You want to have some variation here, some distance between your white point and your black point, because otherwise you're going to make this edge too hard. The edge between white and black will be too hard, and you get this
crunchy looking
jaggedy edge, and it'll look kind of cut out and odd. So we'll say this is good. We'll click on here, and then again, this is where you use burn and dodge and blur tools. Okay. So we'll dodge out these areas here. Since it's set to highlights, it's not going to affect our shadows. And we can come in here and clean this up.
And then what, once you're done, you just copy and paste it over to a layer mask?
Once I'm done, I can command click on the icon and turn that into a selection.
Ah, okay.
And then that will automatically be a layer mask. So let's come around here. One of the things you want to do is I'll rough in, just make sure the border areas around what I want is pretty well fixed up. And then I'll zoom out a little bit, go to the lasso tool, and do a rough selection. I say that gives us enough. So I've selected the inside. I want to get rid of the stuff on the outside. So if I invert my selection, I can come over here and where is invert selection? I know it's here somewhere. Oh, inverse.
Yeah.
The keyboard shortcut is Command-Shift-I, and I always know the keyboard shortcuts. So finding them in menus for demos is a little challenging. So now the crawling ants are going around the outside. So I'll make sure white is my foreground color by hitting D, and then Option-Delete fills it with white.
Okay.
And I drop the selection. Now, one of the things I've learned, and I think I talked about this with the previous thing, was this looks like it would probably be pretty good. I know there are areas in here that we want to clean up. So for demo, I think people aren't going to want to see us, you know, paint in each every little hole, but they'll have to fix that up. But see, we're here where we thought we had some of the stuff done. A lot of times when you zoomed out, there's a little bit of gray here. You don't notice it well. So that's why we'll bring up the curves tool again. And I'll just bring the black point over here to see, like, oh, look, there's all of this area where there's gray in there that I didn't notice. So I have to come back here and dodge that some more.
Okay, just to visualize.
And then I'll go over here and pull this over and check, this looks like the areas where I want black is pretty black. So I'm looking to see, is there any light grays or dark grays in here that are getting forced to white? So it looks like I just basically have to clean up the whites. And one of the things I could do is pull this over here, pull the white point over, using my histogram just enough here. So let's see if that forced this area in here to white. So we bring it up one more time and check, and yeah, pretty much.
Okay, excellent.
So now I hit cancel out of here because I don't want to do that. So now we've got something here, and this is now black where we want it to be white. So again, I just hit Command I to invert that. Command click on this turns into a selection. Now I'm on my layer. Down here is the make layer icon, mm-hmm. or make a layer mask icon. You can also do it over here by layer, layer mask, reveal selection. And now we have our thing here. If we fill this with the blue we have in the foreground color.
Pretty nice.
You see this needs some work around the edge. Mm-hmm. But overall, this is the mask we had. So pretty quickly, you're able to capture that up pretty well.
Excellent.
So you can finesse the edge around here. You know, it's just a matter of putting in some time. Oh, look, we had a hole in here we didn't notice. And a hole over here we didn't notice. So I bet if we come over here to this tree, that's one of the things about doing the demos, is sometimes
you notice things.
You can see your mistakes when you do demos. So
there
like,
it is.
Yeah, nobody noticed that. Nobody noticed this. But when we come to this tree, which is this layer here, we find I have some adjustment layers on there, but overall what we captured around the mask and stuff like that did a pretty good job. It didn't need a tremendous amount of massaging and stuff to get it. That's one of the things you want to do when you're checking stuff out is you want to look carefully at this. So I don't always zoom in to around 500%, but you want to zoom in close enough where you can see your details and you look for mistakes. You look for, like, is there white showing around here that shouldn't be, or is there something out of place?
Now, on that channel pull technique, whenever you clean it up, would it be the same cleanup technique that you used for the other one, the dodge, burn, and blur?
Exactly. And then sometimes what you have to do is, like these areas here, mm-hmm. you get in with a paintbrush.
Okay.
And I would paint this in. But all around here, like nowadays what I would do is I've got this roughed in, but here is where I would use the Refine Edge tool.
Okay.
And I come over here to Mask Edge. This is where I would come in and I would add a little bit of a feather, put in a negative value here to bring the edge in. And with this, there was pretty much a universal thing here. We got a hard whitish outline here. So it's pretty universal here. So a little bit of feathering, a little bringing it in, and I'm looking at it just enough to bring it in. It'll also bring it all in around here and help clean that up a lot. So I'll do that first. And then go in and check it out. This is also where the contrast and color helps a lot, because if we just had this against white, we may not notice there's a white outline around here.
Ah, okay.
So I want to put a color back here that's going to show me my mistakes so I can catch them where it's easy to solve it, as opposed to 20 steps later when I'm too far, you know, when I'm really deep in it, like, oh! This, or heaven help you if your client catches that on the final output.
Yeah. Just a little plug for the audience. So I'm going to be doing a full show this coming upcoming Tuesday on Refine Edge. So if you were wanting more detail or whatever, we will have more detail than you even want on Tuesday show. So watch for that announcement. Now, could you walk us through all of the major cutout areas on this composite?
Oh, sure. Let's see. Well, let's go through layer by layer and kind of talk about how this is put together. I think that's what you're asking for. The very background here. Mm-hmm. Let's turn all this stuff off. The very background is the sky. This was a stock image from Shutterstock, good source for the stuff. And then we had to do some color adjustment on it to fit within the kind of look they wanted. Now, when I do color adjustments, most of the time I'm using two adjustment layers for this. One set to color blending. You see up here it's set for color blending. And then one set for luminosity blending. And that way, whatever I do in the color blending one is only going to affect the color. It's not going to affect the contrast, it's not going to affect the density, it's not going to get lighter or darker.
Oh, okay, sure.
So you see here, I push the green, pull some blue out. Bringing this down desaturates. This is the RGB curve. Bring the white point down, desaturates your image. So there's a lot of power in this. I use this a lot, and I actually have a PDF where I've written up a guideline on this technique. I call it divide and conquer. Mm. Probably 95% of the color adjustment I do, I use with this method. And I find it's a lot easier, makes curves a lot easier to work
with. So it's just two curve adjustment layers, one of them set to color blend mode, one set to luminosity blend mode?
Exactly, okay. Exactly. And see, this is an adjustment you couldn't do in a levels thing, where you wanted to lighten the shadows up, to drop the contrast in a specific way. For this, rather than just an overall contrast thing. We didn't want the light parts to get a lot darker, but we wanted the shadowy parts to get a bit lighter for this, because it had to all fit within the scope of what we're doing. And when we're doing that, you know, obviously we're looking at it in this context. So like, okay, that sky doesn't work, so we need to use some color adjustment.
So you weren't doing this first. This is just the way it came out after you had it all together and then balanced.
Right. Once we get the stuff in, once we get the pieces in, then you start looking at how you make it all match up together.
Okay.
But I back to the adjustment things. If I come here, let's just make a new adjustment layer, a new curves layer, and we'll have this on normal blending. So if I pull this way down darken it a whole lot, what happens is the saturation increases as well, and it tends to shift towards a reddish hue, particularly in people. It tends to shift a little more reddish, so they get more saturated and more red for this. And if I pull this way, way up, they tend to, okay, in this case it's gone to white, but if I pull it way, way up, it tends to shift towards yellow.
Okay.
So what happens is people are like, okay, I've darkened it down, but now it's gotten the colors off, so now I come up here and I have to adjust the color, and now it's too light, and I have to darken it down, and like you're running around in circles.
Right.
By having it this way, if I decide to, if I make a new adjustment layer and set it for luminosity blending, we'll call this demo lum curves, not verbs, curves. I'm a horrible typist. We do this, and if I, you know, let's bring this up to the top because it's easiest to see this on people. If I bring this way down, you see our guy gets darker, and his saturation doesn't increase the same way as if this were set for normal. See, now he's got it a lot redder. Mm-hmm. Here he's kind of red because we had a red thing, but what we're just affecting here is the luminosity of it. So that's the power of doing it this way. So let's get rid of this thing and get this back. So we got the sky built. Come back here. We got the sky built. We had birds. Now the birds here, there was many layers of birds we put together. These were two of the stock images with the birds. And just to show you really quickly, looks like we're going to run over time. I hope you don't mind.
That's fine. That's fine.
But this was the mask for this was made with a. I shifted this over to the LAB color mode because the blue channel, which had the yellow-blue information, gave me really good contrast here. If you're masking something out against sky, shifting your RGB or your CMYK image to the LAB mode just for making the mask tends to work out really well because the B channel, which is the yellow-blue color, tends to have a really good contrast between your foreground and your background.
Okay.
But this was the mask I made for that, and I combined it with one from the green channel here because I wanted to fill in the middle parts. But that was how we masked this out.
But again this is all before refined edge, so you might very well have chosen a different way of doing it nowadays.
Exactly. For that. But we masked that out. We had a ton of birds, and part of the feedback they had was like, okay, take out these chunks of birds, take out these chunks of birds. So that's why all the birds were merged into one thing, because then I could just mask out birds.
Okay, yeah.
You see how many more birds we had here. And I thought, what's the easiest way? By this point, we weren't moving birds around. We're just losing birds. So, like, okay, what's the easiest way to do it? I merged all my birds into a copy. So we have the birds. We have the horizon. And the horizon here is this was a stock shot, I think. This has a mask applied to it. I don't remember why I applied the mask. I almost never apply masks. I much prefer having a layer mask active where I can go back and fix it. But this is losing some buildings, adding color around the edge for it, shifting the color around for this, adding a little bit of noise in it. I was never quite happy with the color of the trees over here once we get everything in place. It always kind of seemed to stick out a little bit.
Okay, now, so now the water in that was irrelevant, right?
The water was irrelevant.
Okay.
Because we have it covered up by grass. And the grass here is a stock shot like this.
Ah, okay.
This was one of the shots Richard shot in a meadow. So we turn on all these other things. So this was just, this could be a pretty much straight mask here because we're just blending it in with the horizon we already had. We didn't have to worry too much about the horizon. And then duplicate this and drag it over to one side so we can extend it out and duplicate it and drag it to the other side so we can extend it out. So that's what these are doing, filling in the gaps.
Mm-hmm.
This is a little bit of retouching, cloning, and healing and stuff like that to hide the
repetition,
the repeating pieces.
Yeah.
And then this was an adjustment layer here to lower the contrast because as things fade out to the background, we want some atmosphere to come in. And so since you've got all the light bouncing around in the atmosphere way back in the horizon, the contrast tends to get lower. You know, you see the classic thing in the mountains, especially mountains in China, where you've got them receding in the background, they're getting lighter and lighter and lighter as you go. So that's what we're trying to approximate with this part. And then what do we got here? Oh, this is a pathway. The client decided they needed a pathway. For this came in kind of late for that. The pathway here was, you see, this was one of my photos. I collect a lot of shots of textures and things. So I had shot some pebbly texture, and I used that. I extended it out and just copied it out so it was wide enough, and then used a free transform tool to give it some perspective so it looked like instead of being flat at us, it was going away, and then adding in shading here. And you see this, the shading is added in. This is using a blending mode, multiply.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just paint with a low opacity brush. Go in. And then we bring in our trees. The trees here have all these different layers associated with them. So these trees here, the moss tree, these moss trees, these were the ones that were the most difficult to mask out. If we come over here, clicked on the wrong thing there for a moment. This is what the shot was.
Ah, okay.
Now this thing was really difficult to mask out because nothing I was trying was capturing these things well. So what I wound up having to do was hand paint these little areas in here. And you can see it's not a perfectly clean mask. There's lights, bits of light gray and stuff in here. But once we got it composited into our background, and we're looking at it, everything was looking fine.
Okay.
And I literally spent about 2 days masking this thing out. So the last thing I wanted to do was spend another couple of days making the mask perfect. Like, okay, you know, it works really well. It works fine against this. Let's just move on. But I knew to look for problems with it. So making the tree work, here I have a number of layers clipped to this. Again, I'm using clipping group. So the tree is acting as a mask for all this area. This is edging, and this is basically just, you know, all the areas that were coming out, capturing some of the light colored background.
Mm-hmm.
We see here there's some ghosting around there. This is a layer of paint where I'm going in with a small brush, sampling paint, and stroking over these edges.
Like
here.
The hair on the other example.
Exactly. It's that same technique. You know, and advanced techniques are basically just, you know, like I mentioned before, the basic techniques are like Lego blocks, and you just keep building the same basic Lego blocks into more and more complex situations. So that's just what's going on with this. So that was how I was fixing the edges of the mask, getting it so that the edges that were coming in were the right colors. And then here's color adjustment layer. So this is shifting it green. This is darkening it. And then this is, what is this one doing? Oh, this is tone down. Come on. Tone down, bright green. So this is an adjustment layer. Oh, desaturating.
Ah, okay.
I'm desaturating the bright green area here. Oh, that's this. All this area here was bright green. It's just, again, I use my color adjustment layer, my curves layer set for color blending.
Mm-hmm.
I just pulled a white point down to desaturate it and then just brushed it in roughly with a brush. It didn't matter too much. I didn't have to be that careful. And then some lighting effects. And the lighting effects, which we use extensively in this, this is just a layer set for overlay blending, nothing in it, and then I'm dodging by painting white and burning by painting black, or a dark color and a light color, and imagining if the light's coming from camera right, I want to dodge these parts, I want to burn these parts, I want to create some depth in here, so I'll burn that in.
I did not.
And I'll dodge this part
out.
I
thought that was going to be a lot more complicated than that.
Yeah, no, and that's the same way. That's the same way the lighting on these trees are done. If I have it right, yep, these trees here. That's the same way the lighting on these trees are done. Is that what these trees are? Well, that's this one. That's this tree. So that's the same way this lighting is done.
Hmm.
So it's just an adjustment layer, dodging, burning, dodging, burning, burning, dodging, going around here. These triangle trees, that's where these things are. So the triangle trees, again, they all got the same kind of thing. And I made the first triangle tree. They came from this. So I was playing around, masking it out, playing around until I got this kind of a shape out of it, because we wanted it to look kind of like a triangle thing. And then I duplicated several times. I might have played around with changing, you know, if it looked like we had a repeating one, I might have played around with hiding parts or, you know, cloning or something like that just to vary it up a little bit. But once I got the first one set up, I could just take this group of layers and copy them and then move it over and free transform and make it bigger, smaller, whatever. But that's how these things are all putting together there.
Okay.
Then there's shadow layers added below there because, of course, you're going to cast shadows. The bench comes in, and the bench is built the same way here. We have the bench mashed out. We have adjustment layers to shift the color around, get it so it blends in. Lighting layers. The lighting layer is, again, the overlay. So it's just this repeated over and over and over again. The moss balls. Mm-hmm. The lampposts. The lampposts are the one thing that people will catch. The perspective for everything here is one perspective. The perspective on the lampposts up here is another, because they were a stock image. And there was something the client wanted thrown in at the towards the end of the project. So we didn't have time to go out and photograph a wide range of lampposts from the correct perspective.
Yeah.
So a lot of times people will catch that like, ah, good point. That's the one thing you can't fix very easily. Photoshop CC now has a way that you can kind of play with the perspective a little bit.
Perspective warp.
Perspective warp. But you're just faking it. You're not going to see you can't bring this down so you see the top of this stuff that you can't reveal, but you can kind of pull it down a little bit and kind of fake it some. So I might have tried that some if we thought it was necessary to do that. But that's what is going on with the lamppost. So we have two lampposts. You know, it's the same one copied, moved over, and then we adjust the lighting, we do all that stuff. It's all that same thing. To get the sense of lighting in the lamppost, this was the lighting copy, which is where we're lightening and darkening, burning and dodging. This was adding a little bit of color in here, and then this was another overlay layer, just adding in a little bit of yellow paint.
Just a yellow blob.
And the yellow paint is just dodging this a little bit, but giving us some color, so it looks a bit like, the idea was to give a hint that it's early, very early in the morning, the lights haven't gone out yet, you see a little bit of a glow. That's just what the idea with that was. And then the model comes in, and again, we got the same techniques here with this. Now for the model, I think one of the things we want to talk about was how we also adjusted the lighting so the model fit. Mm-hmm. With this. So here was our model. Here was retouching done in the model. What do we got going? Oh, little things like this. One of the things when Richard was photographing the models, he kept asking the client, since the clothing was their product,
right.
He kept asking the client, like, okay, is it, you know, how are the wrinkles? Are we okay? Like, no, wrinkles are fine. And then, of course, when we're working on this shot after it's done, then they're like, oh, can you remove wrinkles? So a lot of stuff we had to remove wrinkles on. And that becomes a nightmare. It's like, if they said remove the wrinkles from here, you've got red lines going this direction and red lines going this direction. So somewhere you have to, like, make the lines make sense. So clothing that has a strong pattern, the best advice I would have for removing wrinkles is to use an iron before you shoot it. So we had a lot of work with that. This is the edging, mostly going around here. Tone down highlights. Where was the tone down the highlights? Probably tone down some highlights somewhere here. And we got the hair work here. And then they decided the skin color needed to be shifted a little bit. It looked a little too saturated. A little too pinkish. So this is a color adjustment layer. It's masked out, so it's just painted in right around where his skin was. Mm-hmm. Sloppy here because it can blend in with the hair, and this part here because it's
masked out.
If I, here we go. We can see this. So this area here, I didn't have to be careful about the mask because the layer mask for this guy was hiding it. But I had to be careful in all these areas here. So knowing where you have to be careful and where you don't have to be careful helps a lot with this. And then we darken the model overall. This is set for normal blending, but this is just pulling it down a little bit, just a little bit of darkening. And then this is a curve to tone down the highlights for that. So this is another curve where we played around with it to look right, and then painting it in where we needed this stuff done. So you see here, it's just trying to catch the highlighters where it's too hot around here because the lighting was a little bit too strong for that. So that's what this is doing. And then one thing that's really nice to add to models a lot too is what I call a glow layer. And it's where I'm thinking like a painter or sculpting with light. Typically what I do with this, a lot of ways of doing it, but the way this one was done was using soft light, making a new layer setting for soft light blending, and then just painting white in. And by painting white in, we're adding a little bit of glow to the stuff and kind of re-sculpting. This helps a lot. This helps a lot with female models, where you're kind of giving the skin a little bit of a nice, healthy glow. If you paint it in with a soft brush, it's a very soft glow. Sometimes people will make a copy, like of the blue channel, and push the contrast around and then fill that, and that could be a crisper looking glow. You know, where the texture of the skin comes out more. A lot of ways of doing that. We can get into that, but that can take another half hour.
It looks like you backed it off a little bit with a layer mask.
Backed it off a little bit with a layer mask. Yep, so it was just on his skin.
Okay.
So we're turning this off. At first I was being a little too sloppy with it. So actually what I probably did with this was, this was done. This wasn't, I take it back, I didn't do this one by just painting it in. This one was done by making a copy of the blue channel, just like we did, pushing the contrast. So I pushed the black point way up. And what it does is the texture of the skin is kept a little bit better this way. And so then I filled that, I turned that into a selection, filled it with white. If we put a layer of black back here, and then set this to normal blending, and turn this off.
Okay.
You see? That's what it is. So that was made from the blue channel. That was this. It's turned down in opacity to 60%. We turned it up to 100%. It becomes more obvious. But this way, when I added the glow, the texture of his skin was kept a little bit better. So that's just how that was created for that. Sometimes I do it with paint. I just paint, circle of paint in here. But that's why I wound up using the layer mask. Because we didn't want it affecting his clothing, we just wanted it on his skin.
Okay.
And then we've got shadow for the guy. And then we had the bicycle.
Mm-hmm.
And the bicycle here, this took a lot of work in here. Not only masking it, which we talked about, we had to retouch stuff out, get rid of the stickers on there. Probably would have been better if you turned the stickers so they're over on this part. But we didn't think about that. Had to paint out the giant logo here.
But that's something I bet a lot of people don't think about, is you really don't want any logos from non-paying companies in your images.
Exactly. And then adding some lighting. So since the areas where it should be in shadow were too light, had to darken those in. This was paint. So this is, I call it paint, and it's just adding more darkening in here, darkening down the edges that are a little too hot. This was shifting. They decided they didn't want it blue. They wanted it black and white.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is adding a little bit of green in where it should be coloring in some green, making sure the color of grass in the foreground and the color of grass here were matching in. I didn't mess this part out. So every time I look in here, I didn't mess this part out carefully. But this is also the crop was going to be right around here.
Ah, okay.
So if you look at this, this is where our vertical crop was going to be for that. So I didn't have to worry too much. And the horizontal crop was going to be here. So this was outside of our expected crop. So I didn't worry too much about this. Again, that's the thing where you spend 2 months working on the project.
And it's cropped out.
You realize it's not efficient to spend a lot of time working on the things that are not going to show somewhere.
Yeah.
But nobody else ever noticed it but me, so again. And this is some grass cover. This was just painting grass for that. These were the curves we added at the very end, so we get rid of that. But that's how it was assembled. So it's just a Lego block style of building, using basic techniques and one step on top of the other, on top of the other, and thinking how it all fits together. Once you get the pieces roughed in together, So we built a background. We put the guy in. Like, okay, we need trees behind him. Put the trees in behind him. We need this. Oh, we need this other thing. You know, once we have all that stuff coming in and building in, then you start adjusting and tweaking things to make sure they all fit together. So it wasn't built like build the sky and then the foreground and then that. It was one step at a time, but kind of mixing and matching how you're working.
Okay. Marvelous.
So it's all done. Everything's done in context to make it all work together. It all has to be seen in context. So a lot of times you can't know the adjustment you'll need to make on the model until you get the rest of the lighting done.
Excellent. Nikki wanted to know, how would you suggest a retoucher build up a compositing portfolio if they aren't a photographer or if they don't know photographers?
Great question. For me, I wind up being too self-critical when I decide I'm going to create an image all on my own. Mm-hmm. That's part of the reason why, like, I started out studying photography, and in around 1990-91, I got swept up in the wave for digital imaging. But I found it was a lot easier being a retoucher than having to come up with my own ideas, and the self-critical part wasn't speaking as loudly to me. So I know some people look through stock images and go, oh, I can combine these things and come up with something cool. So that's one way of doing it. And you'll see a lot of demos on that on Scott Kelby's site or Colin Smith's Photoshop Cafe site. You'll see a lot of demos where, you know, took this stock image and that stock image. But for me, they never really seem to look as cool as when I find a photographer and connect with a photographer and work on stuff.
Okay.
So when I was starting out, I built my portfolio by approaching photographers and saying, you know, this retouching digitally was fairly brand new at the time, but you can still do this, is approaching photographers and offering new portfolio samples with them. And, you know, you may not start off working on the coolest looking images, because, you know, you work on stuff that's more simple or basic in the beginning. But again, it's a step-by-step building up the complexity of what you're
doing.
Plus,
that'd be more realistic to like a real-life work situation anyway, because if you're doing this professionally, there's no guarantee that your next job's going to be a really cool-looking job or whatever. It's going to be whatever you get offered.
Right, right. And, an awful lot of people start off with it. You know, like a lot of the people who do beauty retouching in the area where they are, there's a ton of beauty retouching going on or beauty photography going on. And so they do that. They're not getting offered a lot of movie poster work or compositing work because that's not in a whole lot of demand. I think there's less regionalism now, as I say, because
the
internet,
right.
And the speed. You know, I can throw several gigabyte files around with clients.
Some compositing, though, there's a lag thing there. I mean, if you're going to composite 10 images together and there's a lag between image one and image two and image two and image three, then that's going to be pretty maddening, especially like if you're both experimenting or whatever. Personally, I'd say, you know, go to your local camera shop and go or contact your local community college or high school or whatever. I don't know about high school. That might seem a little creepy, but you can talk to the professor or the teacher or whatever and say, you know, I'm looking to meet up with some photographers or whatever. And I think you'd get some pretty good results like that. And what Dennis's advice was is that, you know, you really do need to be working with a photographer rather than, you know, Google image search or whatever. You're never going to find what you're looking for with Google image search. And then the realistic situation of, you know, working with the images you're tossed as opposed to some abstract thing you've got in your own mind, because that's not the way real-life compositing works.
Right, and in the end, if you start off this way by collaborating with people, you know, the biggest skill is the collaboration skill.
Craigslist. I just now thought of Craigslist. That might work, although you might get some really interesting.
Yeah, Craigslist, I found is Craigslist is not a productive way to find work for anybody that aspires to make money at this
job. Yeah.
You know, the typical thing on Craigslist, we need somebody with many years of experience in their own computer, and we'll pay you $15 an hour.
Yeah. Or
it's like, are you really sure what you're asking?
Or you know, you can work for us in exchange for using our work in your portfolio or something like that.
Right. And, you know, sometimes if you're starting out building portfolio pieces, where for the photographer it's a portfolio piece and for you it's a portfolio piece, as opposed to either of you getting paid to do the job, that can be a legitimate way to do it. But if the photographer is getting paid to create the image, then the retoucher should get paid for their work.
Absolutely.
As well.
Or, you know, a variation on what you mentioned at the very top of the show. If you go on the web and you find a photographer whose work you like, you can say, "Hi, I really like your work, and I want to, you know, be a compositor or whatever. Maybe, you know, can we build a relationship or something?" I think that. And by the way, Nikki recommends Behance for finding photographers you want to work with.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Behance can be a great way. Plus, one of the things that I really found really valuable was wherever you are, especially if you're in a major city area, there's going to be different professional groups for photographers, either PPA, Professional Photographers of America groups, or ASMP, American Society of Media Photographers, or APA, American Photographic Artists. There are going to be different groups like that. And join the groups, go to the meetings, network with the people. It's a great way to meet people face-to-face, especially if you're starting out and you meet people face-to-face and you're honest, like, hey, I want to learn how to do this stuff. You know, I want to work on this stuff. They may start trusting you with smaller jobs to go on and kind of try you out. And if you've developed a friendly relationship with them, you're not so worried. You're not so uptight about, oh, no, if I make a mistake, they're going to think I'm an idiot and never talk to me again. And it's like, no, okay, you know, we've developed a mentor-mentoree relationship here, and I'll help guide you along the process so you can produce the kind of work I need to have done. You know, so meeting people face-to-face that way can be a great way to do it as well.
Joe mentions LinkedIn photo groups.
Yeah. Yeah, on the internet, there's a lot of ways to find people.
And while we're on it, I'll just say go to retouchpro.com and post in the forums. I've seen a lot of people get set up together that way. Somebody says, I need images to work on, and somebody's got a fresh batch that they just did that week, and they post thumbnails, and they say, okay, let's meet up via email or whatever and Dropbox the raw files to each other. So I think retouchpro.com is a great place to do stuff like that.
Yeah, and you know, one other plug, too, is find experienced retouchers and develop a mentor relationship with them.
Good luck with that. I mean, yes, do that. But I will tell you that you run about 50-50 of pissing them off.
Well, I get approached a lot of times for that. And, you know, sometimes if it's a quick bit of advice, I'll give it to them free. Sometimes we meet up and they pay me a fee. You know, do that just at the beginning of the week. Somebody's a mid-level retoucher, had a bunch of jobs where they're supposed to clip out people, and she wasn't familiar with the process. She's like, can I buy an hour of your time and we meet at a coffee house?
Cool.
and you go over all the questions with me? Yeah, but by doing it with somebody who's experienced, you learn the real thing. What I see in a lot of forums, like on Facebook groups, I see people who've been doing it for a week think their experience is every bit as valid as a person doing it for 20 years.
Yeah.
And so what you tend to see is a lot of people going and talking a lot about really rough technique and praising heavy-handed looking stuff, because for the person doing it for a short time, oh, that looks really great.
Blind leading the blind.
And you don't, the experienced voice is going to get pushed to the background because, you know, like, you know, the experienced people aren't going to go on there posting 30 times just to make sure their voice is heard. At a certain point, like, man, nobody's paying attention to what the experienced people are saying, so I'll back off.
Patrick says, if you live in a big city, go to the studio rentals and photography equipment rental companies and ask their recommendations for photographers that you should hook up with. And then I guess then you could call them and say, you know, hey, so-and-so over at so-and-so studios said I should call you or whatever. That'd be a good way to get the conversation going.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. This is a pretty random question, but you're about the only presenter we have that could answer this one. Brandon wants to know, what was your favorite movie poster?
What was my favorite movie poster?
I assume Brandon's talking about the ones that you're working with, and that means that there's some of them that you're not going to be able to show.
Yeah, that is an interesting question. I was just bringing up my website.
Good time to do that. Good time to do it.
Yeah, I wanted to show that. So, in entertainment work, out of all of these, each one has its own different kind of story. This one, the Blair Witch Project, that one was kind of fun. This was done in the, well, I forgot when, what time it was, sometime in the 90s. And the thing that was cool about this was, while it was a very simple looking design, this, we had to strip in this shot of a lady and build this sort of thing in. Getting the shadows coming up here was really difficult, because whatever I was doing, this is back in the 90s, so Photoshop's changed dramatically since then, but whatever I was doing with paint in Photoshop to paint the shadow up here was leading to banding.
Right.
And I was looking really harsh. So at the time, there was another program called Live Paint,
right.
Live Picture. Live Picture that I used. And Live Picture had a beautiful way of working. It worked in, everything was in 16-bit, and the paint was 16-bit, and you just got the most beautiful, smooth-looking gradations when you worked in Live Picture. So I worked with Live Picture in that to create this part, but this was the first poster I worked on that won a Key Art Award. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of like the Oscars for entertainment advertising.
Cool.
So while this was a fairly simple one, that was one of my ones that was a lot of fun to work on, and I really enjoyed that. These here were a lot of fun to work on. These are, this was some image elements I created for Christmas with the Cranks.
Ah, okay, sure.
Which was, scroll down here, this shot. I was working at an ad agency called Bemis Balkan. We did a lot of different imagery work for this. We did a book cover, we did posters, teaser posters, and all that stuff. And these houses were going to be used in almost all of those, pieces. So as we were working on these designs, I said, well, we're going to need the houses to do, so here, just take a few days and make these houses. So we had one stock image of a house like this without any snow or whatever on the roof. It was a stock image of one house, like, okay, we need to make two variations on it, and the ones on either side are all lit up with Christmas decorations, and then the one in the middle is all dark and it's snowing.
Cool.
So this took a lot of work on this. It was a lot of fun, and I'd read some tutorials from Burt Monroy, and used his tutorials in creating the Christmas lights and doing this. But this was probably 4 or 5 days of work, just playing around. And since I was on staff at there, there wasn't a whole lot of pressure about, like, oh no, if the guy doesn't look productive enough.
Cool.
And they gave me the freedom to just keep playing around, like, oh yeah, that looks cool. How about this? How about that? So that was a lot of fun to work on. Let's see.
What about graphically? Just the way it ended up looking.
Oh, this one here, this one, I Am Legend, was one of the ones that was a lot of fun to work on. This one, I was working freelance in-house at an agency called BLT, which is probably does the most in terms of movie posters, and this took several days of working on, but graphically it all came together. Several different stock images of buildings. We had to blend them all so the perspective worked, add destruction, hide things in front of them, add in cars, do a color toning. I think Will Smith's head was stripped on a different shot of his body. The dog was stripped in. But this took about a week's worth of work. Long days, because at BLT, if you left before 11 o'clock at night, you were considered a wimp. But that was one of the things that was great about freelancing at BLT, was they're willing to put in the time, allow you to put in the time to create something really great.
Okay. Well, I want to point everybody to go over to DunbarDigital.com to look at the rest of these.
Yeah, DunbarDigital.com. You can contact me through my website here, too. My website is due for a major revamp, but my email address is Dennis@DunbarDigital.com. So if you guys have any questions about stuff, you know, email me and let
me know. Mentioned people hire you every once in a while to teach them or whatever. Have you ever worked with, like, TeamViewer or something like that over the Internet to give lessons one-to-one over the Internet?
Yeah, we've used Skype a few times lately.
Okay.
A few years ago, Photoshop, Adobe had included a screen sharing thing within
Contact.
Photoshop
right.
That was really great, but then they killed it. And that one was really simple. But now we use Skype, or one of my clients uses one called Join.me.
Yeah, I'm familiar with that. I like TeamViewer. It's free and very responsive. It's multiple platforms and things along those lines. It's great for one-to-one things like that. And you can pass control back and forth, so you can actually work on the other person's screen, things along those lines. So,
TeamViewer, that's a good one. I'll have to check into that.
Now, do you have anything else you would like to show everyone before we depart today?
I think we're coming up on almost 2 hours, and you know I can go on and on and on.
We'll just have to move it to part three sometime in May or something like that.
Sounds good.
Very, very cool. Do you have any courses up or DVDs to sell or books or anything you want to talk about?
Well, I'm just starting to work on a book project. Can't really announce about that. I don't have any DVDs or whatever out yet.
We'll work on that.
But yeah, we'll work on that. The problem with the DVD stuff is a lot of times clients want, or the customers for the DVDs want sample images to work on, and my clients almost never would allow me to distribute.
Yeah, something like that pretty much has to be designed ahead of time, and you're not going to sell enough to make it worthwhile, unfortunately. That's just sad, but that's just the way it is. Okay. I want to remind everybody that this show you just watched is going to be posted to YouTube. I'm pasting in the link right now. Plus, Dennis's previous movie poster show is up there right now. You can go watch it as soon as we hang up here. And, of course, all of the other shows that we've done recently are up there as well. So you can check out some of the specific technique shows and things along those lines. Also, don't forget to go to retouchpro.com/videos to see some of our start-to-finish retouch videos that you can view. Oh, well, thank you. Appreciate that. You just go to the site nav menu up at the top and then go down to Retouch Pro Videos all the way down. There you go.
Oh, yeah.
Very cool. Thank you very much.
Hey.
And
I can listen.
And check those out there. And then there's going to be something there for everybody. Dennis and I were just talking about Carrie's shows. She's got some She's got some fascinating fashion shows there, and she's got a couple of technique shows, like with Apply Image and things along those lines. But there's something there for every taste. And while you are there, please become a patron. We really need a minimum of 5 more patrons, and that can't be too much to ask, but more than that would also be marvelous, so we can build up a little bit of buffer for May. Excellent. Well, Dennis, thank you very much for sharing your time with us. I apologize for the overage there, but you've been very generous with your time.
Well, it's a lot of fun to do these.
And we'll hopefully be able to work up something for the May show. So thanks to everyone for turning out today. Thanks again to Dennis for his time. And I will see you in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Dennis.
Goodbye.